Hey everyone, Wags here from Eagle Dynamics. Perhaps one of the most complex and confusing aspects of operating the Hornet is correct use of the air-to-air radar. The APG-73 is a mechanically scanned pulse Doppler radar that is not a magic sensor that can detect anything in front of it. Rather, there are several factors that determine what it can and cannot see. In this video, I'll go over many of these factors, and in the end, I hope you'll have a better understanding of how best to use a radar and understand its limitations. As you might imagine, many of these same principles will also apply to the F-16 radar. Let's get started. It probably goes without saying, but the range setting simply sets the scale of the radar format. It does not affect the actual range at which the radar can detect a contact. If you wish to display a target at 40 miles, for instance, you would need to have the scale of the radar set to at least 40 miles. In this example, we have a target around 42 miles, so we don't see it on the 20-mile scope, nor do we see it on a 40-mile scope. If we increase to 80, now we can see it. If we decrease back to 40 or 20, again it will disappear. Because the radar searches in front of your aircraft in a cone pattern, with you at the pointy end, contacts left or right of the cone will not be detected. To detect such contacts, you can either increase the azimuth setting of the radar and thereby increasing your scan volume, or slewing the radar azimuth to the selected location of the contact. If you increase the azimuth though, recognize the contact update will be slower. Combined with a low target aging setting, the contacts will disappear. Here we have a target of 40 miles with an azimuth setting of 40 degrees. As you can see, the search area is to the left of the target. With enough scans, eventually the target disappears. If I now recenter the scan over where the target was, it reappears. Now I'll move to the right. And again, you can see the target will fade out over time. The bar setting controls the total vertical scan volume of the radar, and this can be 1, 2, 4, and 6 bars in repeating raster scan. The 1-bar setting provides the fastest contact updates, but the smallest vertical scan volume, whereas the 6-bar setting results in the lowest contact updates, but the largest vertical scan volume. Just like the azimuth setting, a large volume can result in drop contacts when combined with a low target aging setting. In this example, I have a bar setting of 1, with a search area at the cursor of 23,000 feet to 7,000 feet. I can see a single contact at my level. I've now switched to a 6-bar scan, and you can see the total elevation at the cursor location has increased dramatically. I can also now see an additional target above me. If I now reduce back to a 1-bar, we'll see that the elevation area reduces, and the target at the higher elevation will disappear from the scan. If a contact is not detected in the set target aging time, it will be removed from the radar format. So if you're searching a large volume based on azimuth and bar, contacts can easily disappear from the display if they've aged out. You may find that a setting of 16 or 32 works best when searching a large volume. You can see I'm searching a very large scan volume of 6 bars and 140 degrees. With a 2-second age, so even if I have a hit, it's going to quickly disappear from the display. I'm now going to switch my age to 16 seconds, in which case a contact brick will stay on the display for 16 seconds. Additionally, the LNS cross will stay in memory mode much longer. As you can see, each hit of the contact displays a contact brick which will last for 16 seconds, and over time this gives you a much better appreciation of the contact tracing. The maximum age is 32 seconds, and this is probably best for the largest scan volume, as it provides the longest history. Just as with the azimuth setting, the contacts will have to be vertically within the acquisition cone volume of the radar. To solve this, you can either increase the bar setting to increase the total vertical scan volume, or tilt the radar cone up or down using the elevation control. Ahead of me are aircraft at 5,000 feet and 25,000 feet, and above and below my cursor is the elevation scan area at the cursor location. I'm surging between 20,000 feet and negative 3,000 feet, so I pick up the target at 5,000 feet first. If I tilt up to 36,000 feet to 13,000 feet, I now pick up the target at 25,000 feet, and the target at 5,000 feet starts to disappear. I'll now tilt the elevation scan down again, so the target 25,000 feet disappears, and the one at 5,000 feet reappears. The radar can operate in three pulse repetition frequency, or PRF modes. In high mode, the radar is putting out the most energy and is best at detecting high closing, high aspect contacts at long range. However, high is greatly limited at detecting low closure, low aspect contacts flying away or perpendicular to you. Medium mode has less detection range against high closure contacts flying toward you compared to high, but is superior at detecting low closure contacts and low aspect. Interleave alternates high and medium PRF in each bar of the raster scan and is thus a compromise between the two. Based on this, optimal detection range is based on the expected contact aspect closure rate and then matching that with the best PRF. So for a likely contact flying at you, select high. For a contact beaming or going away from you, select medium. And if you have no idea, go for interleaved. Ahead of me is a target at 20 miles flying away from me at low aspect, so I pick him up pretty well in medium PRF. If I now switch to high PRF, I pick up the one much further away, closing at me at high aspect, but the one closer to me at low aspect starts to disappear. If I now switch back to medium PRF, the one further away will start to disappear, and the one closer to me flying away reappears. When a contact is below you and flying nearly perpendicular to your flight path, there is no Doppler shift between the contact and the ground, and the contact can be lost. This is termed the look-down Doppler notch. For optimal detection range, maintaining a track, a look-up scenario is your best bet. However, this needs to be balanced with the advantages to a medium to high altitude missile shot. Ahead of me is a high aspect cool altitude target in track while scan mode. Looking at the vector of it, you can see that it's very gradually now starting to head off to my right. At the same time, it's losing altitude to force me into a look-down situation. The contact now is fully in the look-down Doppler notch and is disappearing from my display. Because of a contact age of 16, I'm still getting some histories on this. At this point, the contact's completely disappeared. The radar cross-section, RCS, is the radar return value of the aircraft. This can vary based on shaping, materials, intake shape, and more. For aircraft with no RCS-specific reductions, it often comes down to the size of the aircraft. Given this, in general, large aircraft like bombers, tankers, and AWACS will have much larger RCS values than small fighters like a MiG-21, an F-16, or a MiG-29. The higher the RCS value of the contact, the further out we'll be able to detect it on radar. Ahead of us are two aircraft at the same altitude, aspect, and airspeed, a TU-22 backfire and a MiG-21 fishbed. And we can see that we're already detecting the backfire at almost 80 miles, but we have no detection at all on the MiG-21 at this point. I'm going to go ahead and speed up time until we can see that MiG-21. As you can see, it's not till 40 miles to detect the fish bed, and really illustrates how important RCS is. To make things a little more complicated, let's throw Datalink into the mix. When in latent track while scan mode or track while scan mode, position of friendly, unknown, and hostile contact symbols can also appear on the radar format display that you can actually not detect on your radar. An AWACS Datalink contact is indicated as a small diamond that you cannot look onto because your radar does not see it. In this first Datalink example, we'll take a look at another fighter as a donor. As you may recall from earlier videos, the top half of the HAFU represents what we see, and the bottom half of the HAFU is what our donor sees. I've moved the scan off to the left, so only the donor was seeing the contact. At this point, only the donor sees his contact, indicated by only the lower half of the HAFU, so it can't lock it up. If I change my scan over the target now, it pops up again, and I have a full HAFU, and if I want, I can lock it up now. In this next Datalink example, all the contacts from a C2 surveillance asset, in this case an E2 Hawkeye, and I have my radar scan off to the left, so only the E2 is reporting the contacts. These are indicated as small red diamonds, but I can't lock them up because, again, my radar is not seeing them. But I do have indications of altitude, so I can move my radar onto them and get detection, and if I want, now I can lock them up because I have full HAFUs again. It's important to remember that Hornets do not operate as singles, instead they operate as a section, a division, or greater. When doing so, aircraft will be assigned different search areas that allow them a faster scan time of their area, rather than a single aircraft scanning a large area at a low scan time. So when flying online with your buddies, consider an agreed upon search contract. When selecting an ACM mode, the acquisition time can vary based on the selected mode. The more narrow the auto acquisition search pattern, the faster the radar will likely pick up the target. A tight search pattern like boresight will most often find the target and lock onto it much faster than wide acquisition search pattern given the much larger scan volume that the radar is searching. In general, the order of acquisition speed goes from bore to vertical to guns to wide. I hope you found this video useful and provided you a better understanding of why the radar can and cannot detect targets. Thanks for the fish.